Hello everyone, and a very warm welcome to tonight's perspective lecture. I'm Lynn Kyle, the head of the Girls Division, and I'd like to welcome those of you who are members of Bolton School and friends of Bolton School too, but also those of you who've joined us from other local schools and those of you who've joined us having seen us on social media. This is the seventh of our perspective lectures. We've covered topics such as women leaders, journalism, careers in fashion, in engineering, in architecture, and medical careers. And tonight, as you're aware, we're focusing on creative careers. The next of our perspective lectures is on the 2nd of March, in which we'll be focusing on sports-related careers. And I hope that some of you may choose to join us for that too. You're very welcome tonight. You will enjoy talks from four of our old girls, our alumni, some of whom are recognised from teaching them as they came up through the school. And I know that you're in for a real treat tonight. I'm going to pass you over now to Taya, one of our Year 13 students, who is going to introduce each of our speakers.
Good evening, and thank you for joining us tonight and listening to a selection of our alumni talk and discuss their career paths in the creative industry. The creative sector is growing in the UK economy, and in 2019 it contributed £115.9 billion, accounting for about 5.9% of the UK economy. Alongside its financial contributions to the economy, it also believes that the creative industry contributes to community cohesion, the reduction of social exclusion and isolation, and can make communities feel safe and strong. The creative industry includes a vast array of career paths from advertising, fashion, the performing arts and music. Tonight we will hear from alumni who will cover a diverse range of creative roles. Firstly is Lucy Fish, class of 2010, who is an actor and voiceover artist. Her work includes playing Daisy Goodwin in radio soap opera Greenbourne, and lending her voice to well-known brands such as Sainsbury's and Superdrug. Secondly is Nicole Curry, who is a contemporary still life botanical painter who's a recent winner of the RBS Prize exhibition in October 2020. Next is Caroline Blair, class of 2018, who is currently a student at the Royal Academy of Music. And as a singer of myself, I remember her really well playing the lead in Miss Saigon. And then next is Deanne Cumming, class of 2001, who is the head of development at Synchronicity Films, who's produced BBC series such as The Cry and many other well-known films and TV shows. And then finally, we'll hear from Ailey Gibson, who's currently a world-renowned theatre director at MFA at Burbank University of London, who has also assistant directed The Wonderful Wizard of Oz at the Octagon Theatre right here in Bolton. I'm very much looking forward to hearing from all the speakers tonight, and I will now pass over to our first speaker, Lucy.
Lucy, before you speak, I wonder if I could just say one more thing, and that is, to those members of our audience tonight, you will no doubt have questions that you wish to ask our panellists as the evening goes on. You'll see that at the top of your screen, there's a function in which you can type any questions that you might wish to ask us. Please do use that. You can type into that at any point during the evening, and we will answer your questions at the end. Thank you. So, as Tay says, we'll hand over to Lucy.
Hello, thank you, Mrs. Kyle. Lynn, sorry, we've just been laughing that we're allowed to call the teachers by the first name now. But thank you, Lynn. Thank you, Taya. As you said, I'm Lucy Fish, and I was class of 2010, which I can't quite believe was 12 years ago now that I left school. And when I was at school, my A-levels were in English literature, English language and history. And I went on from school to do a degree in theatre and performance at the University of Leeds. And it wasn't really because I was planning to perform afterwards. It was just because I knew I enjoyed it and I was good at it. And I was advised when I did an internship in sixth form that if you can get into a really good uni, if possible, and get a first class degree or as good a degree as possible, that's often better than slogging away at something you feel you should be doing if your heart's not in it. And while I was there, I decided that actually it was viable for me to pursue acting, which I'd always kind of thought was for other people, but maybe wasn't a sensible choice. But I decided I'd do it anyway. And I actually only applied to one drama school while I was there. And I was really, really lucky to get a full scholarship. So I moved down to London to do an MA at Drama Centre London, which is where actors like Tom Hardy, Helen McCrory and Piers Brosnan trained. And when I graduated, after I'd been acting for a couple of years, I really started to crave a bit more stability and control over my career. I was auditioning a lot and occasionally getting the part, but really experiencing a lot of rejection, as is the industry, and it is what it is. So I started researching voiceover, and I found that I had a bit of a knack for it. And I pivoted for a few years to really focus in on it. And once that became very regular and lucrative for me, I could then balance my time between acting in a visual sense and working in the recording booth. So I was asked, why pursue a career in the industry I work in? Well, the first thing I thought when I was asked that question is that a lot of things came to light during the pandemic. Well, a lot of very serious things, but in terms of career, I realized that a lot of the jobs we'd always been told were safe and secure actually weren't anymore. My friend who's a pilot, which we'd always been told, you know, was a really safe job and there'd always be jobs there because there's a shortage of them, lost his job. And friends with businesses in hospitality and retail went under. And we realized that actually nothing's ever a safe bet. So we just don't know what's going to happen in the future. So you really may as well do the thing that lights you up and you're going to jump out of bed in the morning excited to do. And chances are that's the thing that you'd excel at anyway. And for me personally, what I love about my work is the variety. Most recently, I've done a theatre production set in the 1800s, which is so different to being on set shooting for film or TV. And in terms of voiceover, I can be doing video games or radio drama in the morning and then a commercial or a documentary in the afternoon. And it really is different every day and every week, which I absolutely love. I get to be creative and I get to nurture my own client list as well as working with a top agent, and I get to be flexible and never have to ask permission to book a holiday, which for me is a winner. And what else? I was also asked what skills do I think are necessary to be successful in the industry. Well, as a voice actor specifically, I always say to people starting out that there are three sides to the voiceover triangle. And if any side isn't as strong as the others, it's not going to work. So the first side is skill, which comes from training and experience, as well as natural ability. The second element is the business side, which you need for your networking, marketing, accounting, client relations, things like that. And then the third part is the technical. As nowadays, to work full time, you really need to run your own studio setup. Even just a few years ago, you could just live near a big city like Manchester or London and be fine. But nowadays, that's kind of the cherry on top. And most people are working from their own booth, which I've got behind me here. Little padded box, which I sit in all day, but I love it. I know that's quite niche though in terms of voiceover, so I thought I'd also answer more generally about being successfully self-employed as any kind of creative freelancer. And I really think it's a lot of the things that school taught us. It's independence and holding yourself accountable, determination, even in the darker times as well as the more successful times. And ultimately, I think it's the passion for what you do that really shines through, and that excitement about your work, which helps you make a name for yourself and continue working. And that's it from me. Thanks so much for listening.
Hello, thank you very much, Lucy. That was really, really interesting point of view to start us off with, particularly interesting that reflection on the pandemic. So we're going to now hear from Nicola Curry, who is a contemporary still life and botanical painter. And she is particularly inspired by the beauty of the natural world, and I believe currently artist in residence at Spetchley Park Gardens near Worcester. Okay, I'll hand over.
Thank you. Well, thank you for inviting me here tonight. It's good to be back, although not in for real. When I left Bolton School so many years ago, I never imagined I'd return years later to talk about my career as a painter. I joined Bolton School in my sixth form, and it was really different from my previous school. Pupils commented on my accent. I was from the south. Actually, I was only from a few miles south of Manchester, but even more shocking was that I wore makeup, and this definitely wasn't allowed. I did A-levels in music, RE, English and General Studies, not art, although ironically, my nickname was Salvador because my surname was Dali. I was interested in art from a young age, and particularly colour. My father was a watercolourist and worked in the textile industry, and he used to bring back different colour samples of fabric designs, and I was really fascinated about how the same design would look so different in different colours. My RE teacher at the time, Meg Chignall, who was also my form tutor, really encouraged this artistic interest with talks about art history and appreciation. She also inspired me to study theology at Durham. But my career as an artist really began in my 40s when I did an art degree. My earlier career had involved teaching in Africa, writing and publications, and these all fed into my art practice. In Zambia, I was really challenged by my own cultural assumptions. Working in public relations and communications and in writing for children, it became really important later on as a self-employed artist, where you've got to write about your work and promote it. After completing my art degree, I taught, and this was first in comprehensives and later as head of art at New College Worcester, which is a college for the blind and visually impaired. These posts really helped me try out new materials and different art disciplines. I didn't do a foundation, but these really fed into my art practice. At Worcester University, I was drawn first of all to ceramics and had several exhibitions of my sculptural work in porcelain. My particular interest academically was in art and spirituality, and this linked to my first degree. But later studies in painting as my children were growing up led me to work as a painter. I came to specialise in still life and botanical work, and both enabled me to explore colour. Recently, I've been working on gold leaf as another source of light within my work. Looking back, why did I start as a painter? Well, like Lucy, it was a passion. It was a passion I wanted to explore. It wasn't sensible to start in my 40s, and financially it was actually at some cost. But I love the way a day can start with a blank canvas and end with something unique and original. Painting made sense. It brought together the many different skills I'd developed as an artist. I also actually really enjoy being my own boss and organising my own time. Every day is different. So what skills are needed? Well, in my case, I didn't actually learn painting at university. That came later through adult education courses and the Norfolk Painting School. A degree can just be a starting point, and a fine art degree can lead to a number of different careers. Skills in communication, I've mentioned before. You do have to speak about your art a lot and help publicise it. Finance and administration, artistic careers are not necessarily well paid, but the material costs, especially if you're a painter in oils, can be high. most painters combine their practice with teaching, writing, or community art projects. It's important to be financially realistic if you're exploring your passion. You also need to keep good financial records as a self-employed person. It's helpful to have good administration skills, otherwise that side of the work can take too much time. I would say you also need resilience. I've had a career where I've worked with people the whole time, and now working as a self-employed person in an upstairs attic, it can be a bit too quiet. Artist meetups, group events, exhibitions can all help offset that. I'm now working as an artist in residence, and I'm currently at Spetchley Park and Gardens just outside Worcester, and I'm working in partnership with other organisations can help offset the loneliness that sometimes happens if you're always working alone. It's also important to be adaptable. The definition of art is constantly changing, and digital art, games design, the metaverse are all in the ascendancy at present, and online learning has really mushroomed in the pandemic. Studying for a career in the creative arts is actually a journey into the unknown. I find that hugely positive, but some people could find that a challenge. So what are the positives of this career? One of my former students, who's now working as a professional painter, talks about his art as a marathon, not a sprint. For him, becoming an artist is a lifetime endeavour. Another artist I know speaks of the need to learn the craft of art and practice it for at least 10,000 hours before expecting to become proficient. And my experience echoes that. In one sense, the whole of my working life has been in the creative arts. Becoming an artist, however, was a more gradual process. For me, a positive is the colour. It's a journey into colour. I carry on learning about colour. It's like a musical composition. Mine has been a chromatic exploration. I still remember the vivid blue of the stained glass windows at Chartres Cathedral I saw as a child. I hope to reproduce the excitement of that colour experience in my paintings. I also find it intellectually stimulating as a career to engage with new ideas and different cultures. This is lifelong learning at its best. For me, it's food for the soul and a feast for the eyes. And it's no accident I paint a lot of food. I can play with paint all day. What better job could anyone want? If people wish to know more about my art, these are my details. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nicola.
Thank you.
Okay, our next speaker is Caroline Blair, who left school in 2018. I remember Caroline very well. I remember her voice extremely well. She's a soprano, currently studying at the Royal Academy of Music. And I'll let her tell you more about herself.
Hello, so yeah, I only left school in 2018. And since then I've gone on to do an undergraduate degree at the Royal Academy of Music. My A-levels were Latin, French and music. And people often ask me why I chose to study music at an undergraduate level. I kind of went through school having a lot of interests, and trying to find what you wanted to do was quite difficult, and I didn't really make a decision until lower sixth, where I felt like, actually, no, I really, really wanted to do music, because I know that's quite a difficult thing for people to decide which career path, whether they want to go into arts. And I know a lot of my friends who played saxophone and piano and loved it ended up doing medicine, dentistry, but for me personally, music was the one. And at undergrad, conservatoire is very different to university. I would say that's something that I wish I would have known at the time when I was applying. At conservatoire, it's kind of like school. So you have around 1,500 people in the entire institution across 7 years, all the way up to PhD level. Whereas at university, you know, you've got a lot of people, you're meeting a lot of different people. There's not many societies. It's quite different experience, and it's kind of more of a workplace. It really suits me and I really, really adore it. But I would bear that in mind if you're applying for conservatoire as an instrumentalist or as a singer. In terms of my course, mostly it's very practical and one-to-one based. So I have 2 hours of individual teaching a week with my teacher, my voice teacher, and then half an hour with my coach as well a week. And in general, since the pandemic, it's been quite difficult to kind of have those interactive things online. And through that, that's actually kind of where the music industry is going. You can't really just be a singer anymore. You have to be a singer, you have to be an actress, you have to be able to do your own sound and tech. And I was really, really lucky because I was supported by a scholarship and Leverhulme Foundation to be able to buy my own camera and recording equipment. And that really, really helped kind of gain that knowledge. I would recommend for anyone, if you want to know more about recording or going into kind of like sound production as well alongside your music, the ISM in London, which is like a musicians union, and the MU, those are really, really great things to get involved with. Alongside my degree, I've kind of been doing part-time work, where I've worked at Pret A Manger for a year in the pandemic, and that was great. I think you have to be prepared to be adapted, and it's quite difficult in the life of musicians because you're freelance. You don't really have guaranteed jobs, especially in the classical music industry. You can have fixed jobs if you're in an orchestra, but if you're a soloist or you're a chamber ensemble, it then becomes quite difficult to have steady work. Although that being said, when you're a student, it's kind of a bit easier to get involved in projects when you're younger. So I've been working for a lot of independent opera companies alongside my degree, which are kind of the equivalent of internships, if you're doing law or something like that, and young artist programs. So I've worked with Water Perry, Young Artists, and Tête à Tête Opera. And these kind of things are absolutely brilliant at university. If you can get involved with these kind of things, if you're considering that, I would 10 out of 10 recommend it. Again, if you're wondering kind of what conservatoire to go to or whether you want to go to uni, all I would say is I had a lot of interest alongside, and I realised I could have probably gone and done a degree in something else and come into music. You don't have to feel like you make that decision now, because I felt to me music is a lifelong thing. And if I were to go away from it and come back to it, that would also be okay. And a lot of my friends who are on master's courses at Royal Academy, they went and did like natural sciences at Bristol, or what else have we got? We had somebody do mathematics at Warwick and accounting. So that's, you know, if you love your music, but you don't feel ready to pursue it, that is also completely valid as an artist. And as we were saying about resilience, it's really, really important that I feel like through the pandemic, it's been quite difficult to keep up that motivation, that feeling of, oh, I really know that what I want to do is what I want to do. And even when nothing's on and you feel at the lowest of the low, if you're a musician, don't feel like you have to prove anything. You want to share something, and what you want to share is important. And I would just recommend, if you know you want to get involved and start prepping for music college auditions or going to university to study music, that you could get involved with say, if you're an instrumentalist, there's the National Youth Orchestra of Great Britain or the National Youth Choir of Great Britain. And there are many, many schemes, like the Hattori Foundation offer a lot of support to those who are considering going through music college at an undergraduate and postgraduate level. And yeah, all I can say is it's been a brilliant, brilliant thing to be surrounded by music in a pandemic when you feel like there's nothing else around. And past this, I'm going to be doing a postgraduate still at the Royal Academy of Music. One thing I would say, if you want to be a professional musician, be prepared to be in for a long ride. We kind of, as a singer, it's a bit different for singers. You kind of have 7 years training, kind of like a doctor, if you want to do that. So it's a brilliant thing, but be prepared. It might be a long road if you're a singer, and that's great. I love it. And there's so many ways of funding out there. So I would encourage you to start looking. Hattori Foundation, Help Musicians, and they're all brilliant ones who support and you can contact and get involved with over this time. So yeah, I think that's all from me.
Thank you once again. It's so interesting to hear such diversity in our speakers. So our next speaker is Deanne Cunningham, who actually started out studying law, but soon made the move to television. Has worked on some of my favourites actually, Cold Feet, Endeavour, Humans. And is currently head of development at a Glasgow film and TV production company, Synchronicity Films. So over to you, Deanne.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Good to talk to you this evening. As she just mentioned, I had a slightly circuitous route into the industry. I think the truth is, age sort of 16, 17, I was a little bit lost in terms of what I wanted to do for my career. I probably knew deep down that I really wanted to do film and television, but I didn't know anybody who works in that industry at all. And I just couldn't see a path to it. I didn't know how to get into it. So I just thought it's probably not for me. And I did chemistry, biology and religion and philosophy for my A-levels, thinking maybe I'll be a doctor. And when I decided I didn't want to be a doctor, it left me slightly in the lurch because I didn't want to study any of those at a degree level. So then I kind of thought, okay, maybe I'll try and become a lawyer. And that felt like there was a very clear career path. So, and I didn't need any particular A-levels to study it. So I went on to study law at Magdalen College, Oxford for 3 years, and I did my LPC after my degree. And I, by the end of my second year at uni, I already had a job lined up, a training contract at a sort of big corporate law firm, and it all just sort of seemed to happen without me thinking about it too much. And I spent 2 years in London working at this corporate law firm and just really hated it, to be honest. It just really wasn't for me. It is a fantastic career if you enjoy it, but I soon realised that wasn't going to work for me at all. I really wasn't having fun. So I left after my training contract and moved back in with my mum and dad and was trying to get kind of unpaid work experience and not really getting very far. But then I applied for the BBC's production trainee scheme, which is, so it's like their graduate scheme. It's an 18-month programme where you do 4 different 4-month placements across the BBC. And that was like my stepping stone into the industry. That was really a fantastic sort of first move into television. So, I spent 18 months doing that. And one of my placements there was at EastEnders. And I, you know, I'd always just loved television drama. And so when I finished that scheme, I went to work at CBBC in the drama department there, worked on things like Tracy Beaker and Just William, and kind of in these junior roles, like as a runner and a kind of researcher. Went back to EastEnders for a while to work as a storyliner before getting my first script editor job on Waterloo Road. which is how I first ended up in Scotland. And a script editor role, for those of you that don't know, is your sort of, you're not writing the script, but you're working very closely with the writers to make sure that the scripts are good enough and in the right that they're ready to be filmed, basically. And then you work very closely with the director and the production team and the actors on any questions that they might have about the script. You're kind of the script person. Then I went on to do a variety of freelance script editor roles on shows like Humans, Utopia, The Tunnel for Sky, and wanted to get into producing. Cold Feet was my first co-producing role. We shot some of that at Bolton School, which was really fun. And then Endeavour I did for ITV. And I've slightly pivoted over the last couple of years into script development. I'm not working in production at the moment. I'm actually working for an independent production company, and we're developing a whole range of scripted projects for Netflix, ITV, Channel 4, whole range of companies. So that's a bit more 9 to 5, which works for me at the moment. So that's how I got to where I am. And why pursue a career in film and TV? Well, I suppose the obvious answer for me is that I just think it's really good fun. I really enjoy my job. Yes, it's hard work, and you have days where everything's just going wrong, but I just get to talk about stories all day and, you know, go to these incredible locations and play make believe with a group of incredibly talented people. So, you know, I get to watch films and television programs and call it work because it is. So I really, really enjoy it. And that's the kind of predominant reason that I do it. I find it really creatively rewarding. You know, being a producer is not quite as purely creative as being an actor or a writer or a director, but I get to work with these teams of people who are incredibly talented, and, you know, being part of that creative process is just amazing. It's also really lovely to work on a TV show and then it goes out and it's well received and people enjoy it, and it's really nice to see people kind of enjoying your work like that, the things that you've been a part of. I think one thing that's really important for me, one of the things I really didn't enjoy about the corporate law environment was that I found it quite formal, and I really felt like I couldn't be myself at work. And I think in the creative industries, you know, in film and TV, it's a much more relaxed kind of informal environment, and you're really kind of actively encouraged to just bring your whole personality to work, because that is part of what's going to make you good at your job. So look, you know, I work very hard and everybody takes it very seriously, but I think generally the atmosphere and the environment is a much more, you know, it's just a much more relaxed and informal environment. You know, I don't have to wear a suit, which I do not miss wearing my suit. So that just really suits me, because I wasn't someone who felt I could spend my whole life in a very kind of professional, serious environment. I think also it's a really booming industry at the moment, film and television in the UK, well, globally as well, but particularly in the UK. We've got, you know, with the rise of all the streamers, there's lots of new buyers coming into the market. So there's huge amounts of drama being filmed and shot here. And we're actually facing a bit of a skills shortage. So it's a really good time to be getting into the industry from that point of view. You know, I will also just mention, I would probably be much richer now if I was still a corporate lawyer, let's be honest. But actually, TV is pretty well paid if you're in the kind of right sections of it. And, you know, freelance producer can be on sort of £3,000 a week or something like that. So there is money to be made there. I think, you know, it's slightly different probably than other parts of the creative arts in that regard. It's, you know, you can actually earn a decent salary. So that's always a bonus. So in terms of what skills I think are necessary to be successful, I think flexibility is just one thing that was really important for my success, you know, during my 20s, because it is a competitive industry and there's a lot of people want to do it. And I managed to kind of really just give myself the best opportunity of doing that by being incredibly flexible. And by that, I mean, I moved all around the country. I was based out of London for a long time, but someone said, right, there's a job in living in Kent for 7 months. Do you want to go and do that? I moved to Kent. I moved my whole life to Kent for 7 months. After that, someone said, right, there's another job shooting up in Leeds. Do you want to go and do that? When I spent 6 months in Leeds, I've worked in Manchester. You know, I just went where the work was, which wouldn't be for everybody. And probably wouldn't be for me right now, actually. But I think that really helped me get ahead. You know, again, as someone mentioned, I was effectively freelance. I didn't know where the next job was coming from. I was always on contracts of probably sort of 6 months to a year. So if you want a very steady, stable job, it might not be for you. But if you can handle the kind of instability of that, then I think, you know, it's great. You know, it is long hours if you're working in production. I think on Endeavour, my alarm would go off at 5:30 and I'd have to be on set by 7 a.m. And then I would finish at 7 p.m. and probably have an hour drive to get home. So, you know, it's well paid, but you work really, really hard for that. And I think also production is not necessarily very family friendly if you've got young children, which is one of the reasons that I slightly pivoted. But obviously there are other jobs within the industry that are more, you know, more 9 to 5. And I think just persistence as well. As I said, it's really competitive. And one of the annoying things about film and TV is that jobs aren't really advertised that much. I mean, BBC jobs are, and ITV jobs to an extent, but a lot of it is just word of mouth. So you've really got to kind of push yourself forward and seek out those jobs. And a lot of that, you know, it can be quite difficult at times. There were definitely points where I just felt like, oh my gosh, I'm never going to get another job. And I'd interviewed for lots of things and I got knocked back and I was thinking, oh God, maybe I'm gonna have to go back to law. But you know, I think you just have to really be persistent. And I think if you're really passionate, then that is much easier because, you know, you're doing something that you really love. So, but it can be a bit of a slog, you know, it can be difficult at times. I think really good people skills. Again, film and TV is really based, it's an industry that's based around relationships. So you really have to forge those networks and you just kind of have to get on with people really and be a person that other people want to work with because it's, you know, it can be quite intense and it's very collaborative. So you have to really be good at working in a team and getting on with people basically. And just creativity, you know, the producer's role obviously has a side of it, which is organizational and you've got to be good at budgeting and finance, etc. But ultimately you have to just have loads of really good creative ideas as well and be able to spot those creative ideas in other people. So those are, I think, the kind of key things. But yeah, it's something that I love and that I've always had a passion for. And I think, you know, if you've got that passion for it, it really pays off. So yeah, I think that's it from me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sounds very exciting. So our last speaker is Ailey Gibson, who I think I taught her A-level drama. She's a freelance theatre director and facilitator and currently resident assistant director at Theatre by the Lake. And she's also studying for her theatre directing MFA at Birkbeck. So lots going on for Ailey, and I'll hand over to her.
I'm a theatre director and a facilitator, which means that I work with communities alongside shows going on in theatres as well. We work with youth groups and try and make work that is really grounded within the communities that the theatres sit within as well. So whilst I was at school, I did A-level drama and I left Bolton School in 2016, only 6 years ago, feels like 2 minutes ago. And after leaving school, I was left with the conundrum of, should I go to drama school and focus on becoming an actor? Because that was the dream at the time. Or should I go to university and do what everyone said was a sensible thing and get a degree and keep my options somewhat open? And I decided to take the route of university. So I ended up studying drama at Loughborough University, which most people think is an odd choice. Well, I go to Loughborough University, a university that is renowned for sports and engineering. But what I discovered on when I was searching around where I should go on the audition days I had and the interview days I had was just meeting the people and finding that a lot of the time the right place for you is might not be the first thought that comes to mind, and that actually courses themselves, no matter where they are the important part of it. So whilst in my first 2 years at doing my degree, I realised there was more to theatre than just being an actor. And although that's what I was focused on in that first year, I had some opportunities come along in my second year with the stage society that was at Loughborough University to direct a show. So I directed Little Shop of Horrors for the university, which was quite a daunting experience. I'd never done anything like that before. And whilst creating that show, I realised that maybe this is something that I would like to do and something that I wanted to pursue. Being able to have a vision for a production and be able to bring that to fruition and work with every single person that it takes to make a show, whether that be set designers and lighting and all that, because you as the director have all of that, those contacts, so you are that person that has a finger in every pie, which is really exciting. So after my second year of university, I actually decided to take a year out and to figure it out a bit. And so I ended up working all over the UK in any theatre that would have me, doing whatever job that they would give to me. So I started off at the Octagon in Bolton, working as a technician, and did a brilliant but mad show in Queen's Park in Bolton called Gulliver's Travels, where I was rigging lights and speakers. Again, something I'd never done in my life before, which was just giving it a go. And then I moved in at being
okay. It looks as though Ailey is having some technical difficulties there. Don't know whether she's going to be able to bring herself back on. Right. Can other people on the panel hear me?
Yeah.
People on the panel can hear me. Right. I think the best thing might be is if we now go to questions and answers. If Ailey comes back in, we can rejoin her. But I'm going to hand over to Sarah Talbot, who is our head of theatre, drama and public speaking. And she will handle the questions, and we'll watch out for Ailey coming back on.
Thank you very much, Helen, and thank you to the speakers for a really wonderful evening. I'm going to try and group the questions that we've received so far so that we can focus on the different careers represented this evening. Lucy, if we could start with you, a question has come through regarding accents, and whether you have any advice as to how our student actors might learn accents or broaden their accent capabilities.
Yes, for sure. I find with accents that the best way is to fully immerse, like put everything I can in the accent. So I'll put my sat nav in the car in that accent, you know, Siri on your phone, start listening to bits from if you can find like podcasters in that do a podcast with that accent, just so you're hearing it all the time, and whenever you can just pause it and repeat the phrase back so it's constant. That said, there are many accents I just wouldn't embarrass myself with. I think I've got quite a good ear for accents, and most English accents I can do, but there's been times when I've been asked to do like a Welsh, and I've just thought it's not worth the embarrassment. You're best off with someone else. so I'm just honest about it. But yeah, immersion, I think, is the way.
Super. Lucy, thank you. Thank you very much. So a question that came through whilst you were speaking and has been repeated since has to do with the idea that there is a possibility earlier on in our careers we might have to deal with rejection. And I think speaking as somebody who's had a conversation about this with parents of aspiring actors, I was hoping that perhaps you could give us a little bit of advice there as to how that works out. What exactly does that look like?
Mm-hmm, for sure. Oh, I really wish I could say it gets easier. I would love to say that. I think it's always going to hurt. The more you have your heart set on something and the more rounds of auditions, and it always seems to be the time you get the recall and then another recall, and you're in the chemistry test and it's between two of you, and then you just at the last minute you lose out. And it doesn't get easier, but what I would say I've found is that when I first graduated, my whole life was, I'm going to be an actor and I'm going to make it, and I've got things to prove, and it very much consumed me. And as my life got fuller, as I got older and I've had other interests, it meant the less desperate you become for it, you know, the more happiness you've got in other areas of your life, the easier it is to deal with, because you are putting less of your self-worth in it. You know, if you can think of yourself as more than an actor and be other things and have other strings to your bow, like I've got voiceover, other actors I know are also personal trainers, are also teachers, have got other things going on, and the more full your life is, the more things you've got to just make that rejection that bit easier.
Thank you, Lucy, so much for that really illuminating answer. I think we might be getting Ailey back, possibly.
Yes, I think if we can cut to Ailey, that would be great.
Hi, sorry about that. My Wi-Fi decided to die. So where was I? Oh, yes. So I was on my year out traveling around working as an assistant director with Prime Theatre and Horrible Histories. And then I got the chance to go back to the Octagon Theatre back in Bolton to assist their Christmas show back in 2018, which was A Wonderful Wizard of Oz, which actually happened at the football stadium. And then I moved from there up to Pitlochry, which is up in the Highlands of Scotland. And I worked as a scenic artist and a carpenter for their season for 4 months. Yet another thing that I'd never done before, but just thought, why not? I'll try it. I'll do whatever people need. And from there, I went to Watford Palace Theatre back down near London and worked as an arts administrator, to Royal Court Liverpool, where I worked as a casting director, and then to Theatre by the Lake, which I'm back at now, which is brilliant, as their resident assistant director. But I was working there as a development officer. So I was writing funding applications for the theatre, because a lot of theatres are classed as charities, so they have to apply to lots of places to be able to put on shows. So after that incredible and slightly mad year of moving around the country every 2 minutes, I went back to Loughborough and finished my final year of university with very clear in my mind that I was going to become a director. That was the path for me. So I focused on that during my final year, and I directed our final year production for Loughborough University, which was a bit odd because it was just as the pandemic was hitting. So I directed a radio play over Zoom, which was a strange experience, but brilliant to learn that that is something that we might now have to live with, as a lot of productions are moving maybe auditions online so that we can see actors from all over the UK and we don't have to ask them to pay extortionate amount of money to go down to London for an audition, which is great. So I've learned that skill through that. And after that, I decided maybe I should learn how to do this properly rather than just winging it, which is what I've been doing for quite a while. So I applied to the MFA in theatre directing at Birkbeck, which is a brilliant course. They only take about 6 people every year. and I thought, oh, I'll never get in there. I've only worked a wee bit and at university, and incredibly I managed to get in somehow, and it's been a brilliant course. And the way that they structure it is that they see the director as a collaborator, and it's how does a director work with designers, how does a director work with actors, how does a director work with casting directors, and so on. And through that experience, I was able to work with Rose Bruford Drama School down in London. I trained with their actors for a term, and then I also assistant directed their final year production, which was a brilliant production of Boudicca, which we then took into a theatre in the centre of London called The Uniform. So that was an incredible experience. And then from there, I've been able to get jobs such as I was the resident assistant director for the Citizens Theatre up in Glasgow for 4 months, and I worked on 3 incredible plays with them, and now I'm here with Theatre by the Lake. So it's been a really brilliant experience, and I think that, as everyone said, the main reason you go into a career in the arts is because you love it and because it's your passion, and you're able to create these brilliant shared experiences, especially in theatre. You create an experience for 400 people plus to see in that one night, and that one night will be different to the next group of people that see it the next night, because actors change it up, things change, things happen, it's a live experience, and that's brilliant. And I think that for me personally as a director, creating a story that is completely rooted in a community and telling important stories that people want to be told, that people can relate to, which is brilliant. And I think that theatre in particular has had a huge, has had a massive impact post-pandemic, and during the pandemic, lots of theatres have closed, lots of shows couldn't happen. And so a lot of people are taking this as a challenging time, but I like to try and reframe it in a positive way and go, this is a brilliant time that we can then start to break stigmas that surround theatre, and that maybe once long ago it was a thing for the elite, but it's not. We need to tell stories that everyone can relate to, and that everyone can see themselves on the stage, and that it reflects the world that we now live in, and then therefore we can challenge the norms that have gone by. And so that's what I hope to do with working in theatre and creating brilliant stories. And I think, as was said before, this is a career where, especially as you're starting out, you just have to go with the flow of it. You have to go where the job is. So the longest I've ever stayed in one place is 4 months, which means that it's always a bit in flux, which is fine for me now as at the beginning of my career, but I'm aware that one day that might not be what I want, and that's okay as well. There's opportunities in theatres to, for example, artistic directors, so people who run theatres, stay in one place all the time and get to spearhead a creative organisation and are able to interact with their community in a new way that maybe as a freelancer I'm not able to right now, because I drop in, do a show and leave. And so it's brilliant to one day be able to root in one place. And I think, again, that the network that you create as a director or as an artist or as a creative in any sense is really important. It's not like you can go onto a job site and just see that someone needs a director somewhere. It's all you kind of build a reputation, and then people see that this is a play that you work well with, and maybe you want to come and work with them and they want to work with you, and it goes on like that. So it is all about communication and being able to be a people person at times as well, which is really important. And I think that's it from me.
Thank you very much, Hayley. I'm really pleased that you were able to come back to us, because that was a nice way to finish the talks. So back to you, Sarah, please, if you can pick up those questions.
Thank you very much, Helen. So there is a request here from Lucy, just to add a little bit to her answer on how to deal with rejection in those early years. Thank you, Lucy.
Yes, sorry, I was just reminded of something from what Ailey said. You mentioned a theatre which I've auditioned at before, and I thought actually something that did start to make it a lot easier for me was when I realised that the audition and the rejection isn't necessarily for that one, the audition isn't necessarily for that one particular project. I started to see that even when I auditioned for something and I didn't get it, you were remembered, and that casting director brings you in again. Even sometimes it's been like 8 years later, they'll remember that performance you did and you'll get brought back in. And I started to realize that, like, I think like everyone said this evening, it is a long game. It's not just, you're not just going for that one job. It's about making relationships. So actually, once I reframed that in my mind and I thought the rejection isn't actually a no, it just is a not yet. And the more I learned that, and I saw every audition as an opportunity and an investment in future roles and future relationships, it became a little bit easier to take, to know that I'd invested something and it was useful for not just now, but going forward.
Thank you very much, Lucy. And if we could just segue to a fairly similar question, but maybe in a different sector. A question for Nicola. Would you agree, was it hard for you to get started?
I think yes, in the sense of, I think art careers are difficult to get started. And I juggled different careers in the sense that I was teaching the subject, and I was also doing it. So the challenge for me was actually the juggling, because I wanted to do both to the best of my ability, and both were actually quite demanding. The people I know of the next generation would say that at the earliest part of their career, they had to consider doing a job that paid them enough in order to get their rent. So I think you have to, especially in certain forms of the arts, because I think if you're a self-employed artist, that's a very different ball game than if you're going in to a graphic design art team. But certainly I've known plenty of first class degree students who have supplemented their income from, if they want to be a painter or a potter or a sculptor. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Nicola. And another question for you, if I may. There have been articles in the news about galleries becoming redundant as more and more artists sell directly using social media. Do you find this is the case for you?
It's a tricky one. I think it is changing, and it's changing very quickly indeed. I'm with galleries. I'm with an online gallery and a local gallery. And the online gallery told me that they sold a lot of work in the pandemic. I think there is a danger of, as it were, backing one horse in this by social media. I think social media is a really good platform for getting your work out there. It doesn't necessarily always translate into sales. And it's also how many hours of the day do you want to spend on it? So I think the majority of my sales come from my subscription list, and 70% of my subscription list are people I have actually met through exhibitions, etc. And I think that is a very important contact if you are a painter. I think social media can be a bit false in thinking that you've got all these people following you. Not all, however many hundred or thousand, are going to buy a painting. So thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you for a thoughtful answer. But just finally then, could I ask, has working as an artist in residence helped your career?
Very much so. I got into flower painting quite early on, but I'm not a gardener. So I was spending a mint on buying exotic plants and painting them. when I went full time into doing art, I missed colleagues and enjoy working as a team. So it also provided that side. The good thing about residency is that you are learning about another world which can feed into your art. So last week I was in a meeting with an author and the organizer of the place where I work for events, and the author is doing a book on a famous Victorian horticulturalist, and I'm trying to think what paintings can I do that would link into that story. So it provides another venue and another place, really. And also the people who visit it are interested in flowers and more likely to buy a flower painting.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And a question perhaps for Caroline. We've just heard there how useful an artist in residence programme has been for Nicola. Could you suggest what our students might do whilst at school to build their CV so that they are as competitive as they might be in their particular field?
Yeah, completely. I found when I was going through school, it was kind of really important to enter music competitions. So like, I entered Audley Edge Festival, Rochdale Festivals for music, and kind of the more you enter them, the more confidence you build up as well. It's not just a CV thing. You kind of feel a bit more at home in yourself as a performer. I throughout school, I famously did not enjoy singing, and go to chamber choir, go to the choirs at school. They are so great for your CV. They are absolutely, even if you don't want to do music, it's just great to build teamwork in that way as well. I'd say as well, if you like, willing to learn them, that's also something that can help in the long run with the music's going at the moment, specifically German. The way that the classical music industry is going, a lot of people from the UK are kind of going to Germany. And I started learning German at university. I wish I'd started at school. And it's just a really great thing to have on your CV. And there's loads of national competitions, and join your orchestras, join your choirs. They will all be perfect. Also as well, like sports, you know, they want to know that you're more than just a musician, you're a human being. If you like art, that's also brilliant. Just anything that lets out your creative abilities and is a release. Yeah.
Super. Caroline, thank you so much. You said something really interesting there about it not just being about building a CV, but becoming more sure of yourself as an artist. And to that end, if I could just pose a question for you, Deanne, your favourite genre?
My favourite genre of TV, gosh. well, it was... It was quite funny, actually, because when I was a teenager, there was a show called This Life, which was all about lawyers. And then that's why I thought it'd be fun to be a lawyer and why I studied law. So I get quite drawn. I have quite broad tastes. I do quite like sort of genre, you know, like I did Humans and Utopia and things like that. I'm enjoying Yellow Jackets at the moment. But I do think, you know, look, I think there's not a lot you can do when you're at school in some ways to sort of, you know, do actual film and TV work, but I think one really important thing is just to watch loads of it. You know, if you really think you want to work in film and TV, just watch as many films and as much TV as you can, and start thinking about who are the writers, who wrote it, and why did I like it, and who are the directors, and what, you know, who are the, just start doing a bit of research in that regard, because that will just stand you in really good stead going forward.
Thank you. We have a question from a student here asking, Deanne, how do you have any recommendations for finding work experience in the TV and media industry, especially for the under 18s? Thank you.
It's quite tough, I think, especially, you know, before you go to university. But because a lot of it is that kind of like, who do you know thing. And it is still quite a closed industry. And I struggled with that at first. And I would just like desperately be asking everyone I knew, like, do you know anyone who works in film and TV? Please, can you give me that email? And I would literally be, you know, emailing people I'd never met before, asking them if I could go for a coffee and things. I think you should do that. And I think because we've all been there and we've been the one doing the emailing, we're always quite open to chatting to people and having meetings and giving advice and things. So I think don't be scared to just, even if someone's like in, seems like quite a senior position, don't be scared to, if you can get hold of their email, just drop them a line and say like, can I come and spend a day on set or something? Because it's, you know, that is how it happens, really. There's not really anything else you can do apart from that. The BBC does have some, you know, runner programs and things, but probably not until, you know, you're a bit older. So I think that's the best thing that you can probably do at the moment, really.
Thank you very much. I am conscious of time, but Ailey, there's been a question which perhaps I'll pose to you, and then if other speakers would like to contribute their thoughts, perhaps one of the most, well, surprising and positive messages tonight is that despite the recent years and all the difficulties that have come about as a result of COVID, you are still passionate about the shared experiences that make your job the joy it is. You also mentioned that now is the time to break stigmas within the industry. You sound really positive about the future, about your future within the industry. And I think if we could end on that note, hearing a little bit more from you on that, that would be absolutely super.
Absolutely. I think that we've come out of 2 years where we can't see other humans other than through a screen. So now we're reaching a time where we can interact with each other. And it's a time where we really can start to have those experiences again, which is really exciting. It's what theatre for me is all about. You sit next to someone and you have the same experience, but you might get something different from it because you bring your own yourself to the theatre as well. But I also just think that there's been such a shift in the world culturally, socially, politically, over the past few years now, and now is the time to make to dig your heels in a bit and make those changes and make sure that we hold each other accountable to make sure we make those changes. And it's really exciting that we can do that and that we're able to enact that change now that we're back in an almost, not quite, but nearly there, normal world again.
Thank you very much, Ailey. And just before I pass over to Taya, who is going to close the evening for us, I wanted to invite other speakers to just comment on where they feel they are in light of the recent years of hardship, and perhaps it's not too naive to believe that there will be opportunities for our aspiring actors, directors, musicians and artists.
I certainly think after quite a couple of years, the TV and film industry is really booming, and we're seeing absolute record numbers of production shooting here. And yeah, it couldn't be a better time really to be working in film and TV.
Yeah, no,
thank you very much.
It's the same in classical music. It's going to boom after COVID's ended, and I think people are very scared about rejection. Don't be scared about rejection. It's going to boom and everyone is welcome, whether you're amateur or professional or not.
Mm. Yeah, same as an actor, but specifically as a voiceover, if anybody does happen to be interested in that, it used to be such a closed shop in that there was only a few people that did it who were local to Soho or Manchester. And because now of technology, it's so accessible that even the price of technology and the price of having hardwired internet and being able to have sessions with people all over the world means I work with people in different countries every day, and there's just no barriers anymore. It just seems to be that the access and the entry and even just access to information, you can find out anything online now, and there's courses and you can find out people who've got a similar career as to what you would love to do and just get in touch. You can find people on LinkedIn now or the Bolton School network as well. And just ask. I find more often than not, people are really happy to help.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And with respect to the Bolton School Network, I think it might be time for our very own Taya Panter to take to the floor and wrap up. So thank you all so much for answering those questions, and thank you, Taya.
Well, I just want to start off by saying like a huge thank you to all the speakers tonight. Lucy, Nicola, Caroline, Ailey and Deanne, for giving us like such a great insight. I've learned so much tonight. I've made so many notes on my phone about this. I think it was just like, it was really interesting hearing about how the pandemic has positively affected the industry, because when I was thinking about this time last year, trying to do choir online and trying to have singing lessons online, it just was an absolute mess. And I kind of never really thought about how it could benefit people sort of with auditions and traveling, and how it sort of led to this sort of boom in the TV and film. Definitely interesting hearing about what Deanne had worked on. I'd heard a lot of those shows, I'd seen a lot of them. I absolutely love The Tunnel. I really enjoy that. And it was just great to hear such a diverse range of speakers, but also hearing that everyone clearly has a massive passion for their work. And I don't think you see that as much in any other sector besides the creative industry. I think it's just, it's great to see that every day is different and jobs can get really repetitive, and how you can be really independent working in the creative industry, and you really do learn a lot of skills, and how it's really important to have a really full life doing it as well. I think that I never really thought about that sort of thing. And it was just really important advice to give everyone, not sort of dwelling on the negatives or sort of rejection, but also a lot of the positives. So I just want to say a huge thank you to everybody, and I hope everyone's left feeling as inspired as I am. So thank you.
Thank you.
I will echo that gratitude. I think it is quite clear that this is a career path that both requires but also stimulates passion, energy, commitment, dedication. I think to quote one of you, and probably to paraphrase you all, there is a real pleasure in doing what you love every day. On behalf of the school, I do thank you all for sharing your career paths with our audience. I'd like to thank the audience themselves for attending here and making this into such a strong event. I'd also like to thank Emma Metcalf and Sarah and the careers staff here for organising these events, which do give such good opportunities for our students, for students from other schools, and the wider public. Thank you very much.